Hello everyone, welcome to lecture 15. We'll continue talking about the electromagnetism in chapter 10. So in the previous lecture, we've seen the Gaussian law of electricity and Gaussian law of electromagnetism and Faraday's law of induction and Ampere Maxwell's law that integrates the magnetic induction with the electric field and the current density. And these laws can be expressed as an integral form as shown in the left column, and also it can be expressed in differential form to apply at a local point using the divergent and gradient. And using these equations, finally, we can derive the wave equations for the electromagnetic wave. So from the Ampere Maxwell's law, if we differentiating the this Maxwell Ampere's law with respect to time, like rho and rho over t, round and round over t, then you get this. And from the Faraday's law, we can this replace with electric field, and then you get this equation finally. So the variation in electric field intensity in space and time is gradient square, and electric field is equal to mu times sigma. Here the sigma is the electric conductivity, and here mu is the magnetic permeability and epsilon will be permittivity. And similarly, also the variation in magnetic field in space and time is also expressed almost the same, just replacing the E with the H. So then electric field polarized in the Y direction considering a plane, electromagnetic wave propagation in X direction is expressed like this. This is called a wave equation. And here E naught is the initial absolute the magnitude of the field, and the gamma star is called a complex wave number, and the propagation also called as a propagation constant. So whenever there is some electric field vectors, time varying electric field vectors, then you have a magnetic field vectors like this, which is orthogonal on each other. And the frequency will be also the same. Electromagnetic spectrum, when we see it, the wavelength changes with the frequency, and let's say that the X-ray is about like 10 to the negative 11 meters, and in that the frequency is 10 to the 19 or 10 to the 20 hertz. And what else? The radio wave that we listen, and the wavelength is about like 10 to the 1 and 10 to the 2, and the frequency is about like 100 megahertz to like 100 kilohertz, 100 megahertz, and like tens of kilohertz, tens of megahertz. And these are some constants that we use in electromagnetism. And if the medium is free space, like a vacuum space, then mu asterisk will be the same as the mu naught, and the epsilon asterisk is the same as the E naught, and the mu naught is the magnetic permeability of free space, and the epsilon naught is the dielectric constant of the permittivity of the free space. And in that case, if there's nothing attenuating and slowing down the speed of light, then the C naught is the speed of light in vacuum, and which is 1 over square root of epsilon naught and mu naught. And that's the 3 times 10 to the 8 meter per second. Just for the record, the Maxwell's great achievement was to analytically express the observed laws in electricity and magnetism, thereby unifying three major branches of science: optics, electricity and magnetism. So polarization, I think in the previous lecture we talked about depolarization, and polarization of bound charges and magnetization of the medium are produced by forces and torques from electric and magnetic fields. On the other hand, inertial and the viscous forces oppose these applied forces and torques. So electromagnetic properties of the material are frequency dependent. The reason that's frequency dependent is because of this inertial and the viscous forces. So we can think of like mechanical analogy here. And when we have on the spring, and the force displacement response will be like this, without any delay or some hysteresis. And in time, the variation will be synchronized with, no, displacement will be synchronized with the force variation. But when we have some inertial or the viscous effect with the dashpot here, and now the force and displacement curve shows some hysteresis like this, which means that you are losing some energy, right? So energy loss. And also it means that because of the inertial effect, you're getting some phase shift like this. So then the stiffness of this equivalent system will be expressed as a complex number, like K asterisk here. So what it means in the electromagnetism is that when the electric field plus and minus this cathode and the anode electric field are alternating with some frequency, then the mass of the molecule inside will affect the polarization speed. So if the water molecule doesn't have any mass, then it will instantaneously switch their position in response to the electric field alternation. But because of the mass of the water molecule and also the friction between the water molecule, that because they are bounded with some chemical force each other, the molecular level force, it causes the viscosity. So it takes time to rotate and polarize. So then this becomes the frequency dependent behavior. When the frequency is in resonance with the the material's resonance, then it will resonate so that it will switch and the response will be amplified, right? And if it's far from the resonance, then it's gonna be quite attenuating. And so that the epsilon or the polar permittivity or polarizability is frequency dependent property. But what about the DC conductivity? So that means that you're applying just constant offset DC as an electric field. So then the charge will move in response to this kind of a potential or the electric field, magnitude of the electric field that's applied, and it creates the current. And this direct current, amount of that direct current will be proportional to the DC conductivity of the material. So in that case, this property will not be shifted. So it will be in synchronized with the external field. So that it's called a real quantity. But if it's polarized, then it becomes like imaginary quantity. And magnetic field permeability will be the same, similar to the complex permittivity. The magnetic permeability will be the complex number because it will have to also the polarized or the magnetized in response to the magnetic field. So the permittivity that captures the polarizability is complex number. So epsilon asterisk is epsilon prime minus j epsilon double prime. And complex permittivity, permeability, which is the magnetizability, is mu prime minus j mu double prime. Normalized with respect to the values of the vacuum, epsilon naught and the mu naught, then you get the relative permittivity, which is we use typically in the geophysics, kappa asterisk. So, and there is a kappa prime and a kappa double prime. And if you do that with the magnetic permittivity of the vacuum, then there is called the relative permeability, and it's mu rel prime and mu rel double prime. And if the material is non-ferromagnetic, so then mu asterisk is the same with mu naught, and the mu double prime will be zero. Standard conduct like non-ferromagnetic like a quartz SiO2 or the glass, which is nothing to do with the magnetism, doesn't have any iron atoms. Standard conductivity or zero frequency current, like DC conductivity, is a real quantity without an out of phase component. An out of phase component of the permittivity, kappa double prime, is in phase with conductivity. And loss is due to polarization, and the conductions are measured together. So effective imaginary conductivity, which is the kappa double prime effective, is the kappa double prime plus sigma over epsilon naught omega. And here saying is that this part captures the loss, and that's been that always when you try to measure it, it's gonna include the ohmic conduction loss and the polarizability loss together. The effective AC conductivity, like sigma effective or sigma AC, is be affected by this kappa double prime effective. So the sigma plus kappa double prime times epsilon times omega. So in some paper or textbook, they use the effective imaginary permittivity. And in some geophysics textbook or the papers, they use the effective AC conductivity. But they are kind of one-to-one relation. They're correlated to each other. And loss tangent is the kappa double prime effective over kappa prime. And when the tangent is much larger than 1, it's a lossy material, and less than 1, it's a low loss material. Okay, let's start from the wave equation, and I think this is just a brief summary again. And the propagation constant gamma asterisk is alpha plus j beta, so it's a complex number. And then this can be expressed with the e to the minus alpha x, which is the attenuation component, and e to the j omega t minus beta x, like that we did in the elastic wave propagation. Then alpha is the, it indicates the attenuation, and beta indicates the some kind of wave velocity. And here the velocity is omega over beta. So the propagation constant gamma asterisk is computed and expressed as square root of this value as a function of sigma and mu asterisk and epsilon asterisk. And here the mu asterisk is the mu prime plus j mu double prime, or the minus, right? And this one is epsilon prime minus j epsilon double prime. And if you replace the this epsilon asterisk and the mu asterisk with these two equations, then you get this final equation. And here the photon non-ferromagnetic material. So here the mu S trig is assumed to be the same with the mu naught. And here, and the C naught is the 1 over square root of the E naught times mu naught. So if you plug everything here, then the final equation will be this one. And from that, you can get the phase velocity of the electromagnetic wave propagation. And this will be expressed like this. And for non-ferromagnetic medium, so then here the also the mu naught. Right? And the final equation will be like this. And polarization losses are much smaller than the conduction loss. So there are some assumptions. And if the conduction losses are also ignored, then here this part becomes zero, then you get the kappa prime square, and this is will be the kappa, so kappa plus kappa times 1 over 2 is kappa, so C naught over square root of kappa will be the velocity. So we can think of the what will be the electromagnetic wave speed in water compared to that in the vacuum space. The attenuation coefficient, so in phase velocity is like correlated to the imaginary value of the gamma asterisk, and attenuation coefficient is related to the real value of the gamma asterisk. And for the non-ferromagnetic material like plastic or some any material without any ion, and it's a non-ferromagnetic material, it's most likely then the equation can be simplified like this. Here this part is the Ohming loss and the polarization. Even if the medium is non-conductive, sigma is zero, the attenuation coefficient is greater than zero due to the polarization losses captured in the kappa double prime. So even though this term is zero, then you get the alpha is greater than zero. And skin depth, as we saw in the elastic wave propagation, is the 1 over alpha, the depth at which the field strength of the plane wave decays to 1 over a. Please read through the final comments. These are the summary of the chapter 10. In chapter 10, we kind of briefly review the electromagnetism, the concept, and some important material properties. And in the next chapter, we'll talk about how these properties are different or vary with the materials. Thank you for listening.